How do stories create that magic in the first place? There are three or four reasons. By evolution, okay, as human beings, we have evolved, okay, listening to stories and creating stories, sharing stories, believing stories and following them. The stories of religion, the stories of currency, the stories of company, all these are stories, all these are fictitious. Okay, and we have come together as human beings, okay, trusting these stories. Third is biologically. Okay, a lot of things which happen, okay, in our body when we hear stories. Emotionally charged situations, okay, like in situations when we hear emotionally charged stories, the brain creates something called chemical post-it notes. This is because a liquid called dopamine gets secreted in the brain, and as a result, these post-it notes are created. Between the storyteller and the story listener, there is something called a neural coupling which happens. And mirror neurons are created, okay, between both when the storytelling and listening process happens. That's what you get from the audience. That's where the leaning in behavior comes, because of the mirroring and coupling. And when the audience hears stories, there is something called oxytocin, which is also released in the brain, which creates the empathy. So if you want to appeal for action, okay, if you want to appeal for donation, please remember the way to do it is using stories, and do it for the right reasons. So that's the link between stories and what biologically happens and when we hear stories or narrate stories. And we can use this power in a business context to gain the support and attention. We want to share strategies or values, okay, and drive changes in an organization. That's where stories come in handy. Yay! The challenges of abstract words that we use when we share strategy is a big challenge. For example, instead of just saying we want to drive better teamwork, okay, we use fancy and abstract jargons like we want to break the silos across the different functional boundaries, and we want to foster a deep sense of trust and collaboration amongst the different verticals, and we confuse the audience, okay, with the abstractness of the language. There's something called a Gunning-Fogg index, okay, and it rates what is the kind of education you should have had to be able to understand a speech. To understand a Steve Jobs speech, it's good enough if you are a fifth grader, fifth standard. And if you have to understand what Michael Dell is saying, you should have passed a 10th standard. And for Bill Gates, he should have at least passed high school to even understand what he is trying to communicate. And what happens as a result of it is, at the back of our mind, okay, we lose the audience. We tend to think that the audience will also know the context like us. So that's the second challenge which comes. The third challenge is the clarity story goes missing. Okay, if we don't use the stories, okay, we miss the audience. That's why it is important to use clarity stories. Okay, stories like this is where we started, and this happened after that. And yes, of course, we were successful during that time, but then came the turn of events, and today we are here. That's where we need to do this. Then comes the anti-story in people's mind. You do all this. You use very simple language. You give your clarity story, but still there are anti-stories, okay, in audience's mind, okay? Because there is something called a belief perseverance, which everyone carries. And especially if there has been a bitter experience before where whatever strategy was shared earlier had not worked. Okay, then during the strategy sessions, during the break, you will see many people around the coffee table, water cooler, giving reasons of why this will not work. You'll say that, oh, I know, last time when you told this, okay, where this happened, and that's why whatever you are sharing now, I don't trust or believe. That's why it is very important while sharing strategy to influence and overcome objections by A, acknowledging the anti-story and saying that yes, the anti-story is true, and talking about what we are proposing now, how is it going to be different, okay, from what has happened before. Make the case and make the point. Not just that, stories also help in solving complex problems. There's something called a Kanawin framework. Okay, in that framework, there are four types of problems. Simple problems, just refer to a manual, refer to a standard operating procedure and solve it. Two, complicated problems, which require some analysis. Sit together as a team, analyze, break it into parts, and solve it. Three, complex problems. No SOP, no manual, no analysis. You have to listen to stories, talk to people, understand what has happened, and that's the only way to solve complex problems. Third type. Fourth type is a fire. Okay, when there's a fire, those kind of problems, just go and douse the fire. Okay, no analysis, no storytelling. So that's the power of stories in organizational context when you want to drive change, when you want to drive strategy, when you want to clear anti-stories, when you want to provide the clarity stories, sharing success stories, and solving complex problems. Okay, that's where stories come in handy and help. Great. What about values? Okay, if you have to drive values in an organization, those are the differences that stories can make in people, say, retaining facts and helping understand the values and strategy better with more clarity. And also act on it, which is very important. And in this book, Indranil also talks about the best ways to start a speech and end a speech. Okay, and he first starts with the worst ways to start a speech. In order of 3-1. Okay, he says one of the worst ways to start a speech is introducing yourself and then acknowledging every person on the stage, extending gratifications, and doing this for 20 seconds. By the time audience A loses interest, okay, and waits for, okay, let this guy finish all this, and slowly switches into their WhatsApp and Facebook, and by the time you start your speech, you already lost the audience. That's the worst way to start a speech. Second worst way to start a speech is giving a long introduction about yourself and what you're going to talk. Okay, that's the second worst way of starting a speech. And what are the best ways then, okay, to start a speech? He says, in a 3-1 kind of an order, the third best way is an imagined scenario. For example, imagine I was in a plane, okay, in 2010, 3,000 feet high, and suddenly we saw fire and we saw smoke in the plane. We were at 3,000 feet. I was in seat 1D. And we could see what was happening, and we could hear the engine giving the sound clack, clack, clack. This kind of stories, like if you start your speech with this, obviously the audience will lean in and listen. That's the third best way of starting a speech. The second best way, especially in a business context, is to start with a shocking factoid. For example, even in a normal context, if you're going to tell children about the importance of eating the right food, if you start with something like this, in the next 15 minutes, 18 Americans who are alive now are going to be dead through the food they eat. Obviously, the children will listen to you when they hear this shocking factoid. That's the second best way of starting a speech. But the best way of starting a speech is through a story. Okay, and talking about your time marker and with a place marker, talking about then giving a specific year, what happened during that year. That's the best way to get the lean-in attention from the audience. Okay, now he also talks about the worst ways, okay, to end a speech. And while there are many worst ways, okay, let us talk about what are the best ways then. One best way to end a speech is a commitment to action, and asking the audience about what they've heard and getting commitment to act upon it. That is one best way to end a speech. Another best way to end a speech is leaving the audience with a rhetorical question in their mind. Okay, on, hey, having heard all of this, will you vote for this guy? Please think through and decide. Thank you. That kind of an ending. The third best way to end a speech, okay, is going back to the story that you started with and linking it up to that story and ending it. Okay, that's the third best way of ending a speech.